thank you very much, mate. And I'd like to thank Infrastructure Partnerships Australia for having me here today, and I'll begin by acknowledging and paying my respects to the traditional owners of the land on which we're meeting today and their elders, past and present. So, to deliver an infrastructure project takes planning, a lot of coordination, and hidden from public gaze, some good fortune. As projects get delivered, all involved move along the learning curve. This industry, your industry, stands among the best at learning from experience, at constantly developing new ways to improve, speed up, and cut costs. The challenge to get better, move faster, and take on more is now as intense as ever. As you'd have heard in the opening address from the Treasurer this morning, that this government has a very ambitious infrastructure agenda, with the state budget funding more than $7 billion in new capital works each year across the budget year and forward estimates. And I know a similar story exists in New South Wales. And anyone who's been listening would know that appetites to take on even more are growing. The challenge to deliver is, I'm sure, being felt by everyone in this room. The engineers feel it, as do the planners, the financial wizards, the lawyers, and there's one other profession sharing this challenge and this excitement, and that's my profession, the public service. Government works best when it's operating in partnership with other sectors. That's true in responding to the Family Violence Royal Commission, pursuing economic transformation and jobs growth, driving an equality agenda, and indeed delivering infrastructure. The true partnership can only be achieved with mutual understanding. So, today I thought that it might be useful to give you an insight into how we, the Victorian Public Service, are supporting the infrastructure agenda. If you like, a glimpse beneath the doona of government enterprise. In addition, I thought I'd also discuss how we're preparing for the release of Infrastructure Victoria's 30-year plan and what it means to move into a longer-term infrastructure planning horizon. Now, as you all know, the government came into office with a significant transport infrastructure agenda. Build the metro, remove the level crossings, extend the train line to Mernda, upgrade Cranbourne to Pack, procure new trains and trams, and the list could go on. As I'm sure you're also aware, a number of these city-shaping projects are under construction or in planning stages already. Now, each of these projects has standalone merit, but when considered together, the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. The interconnectedness of these projects means that each individual project unlocks new benefits in other completed and subsequent projects. Projects such as those I described all work together to reshape the economic geography of Melbourne. For example, urban renewal initiatives at the Arden Station precinct are made possible by the construction of the Melbourne Metro Tunnel, which in turn increases the number of users of the tunnel, improves access to jobs, and facilitates business-to-business interaction. By 2031, when taken together, these projects will have generated thousands of jobs, increased public and private and public income, and lifted the GDP of the state by billions of dollars. Now, the Victorian public service experience with this agenda has been a bit like the engineering of a level crossing removal. The second's easier than the first, the third easier than the second. In working on the first tranche of project decisions related to the infrastructure agenda, we made the mistake of viewing them as projects that should neatly fit into our existing processes. So we beefed up our infrastructure delivery crew, and it's a great crew, but we expected the rest of government to either keep up or just get out of the way. We failed to appreciate just how much value could be gained through accessing and applying the collective intelligence of all of government. Now, not surprisingly, this failure initially meant that issues continued to pop up for last-minute resolution with all of the attendant risks in rushed decision-making, and that related issues not obvious to the core infrastructure agenda weren't given the focus they required. And I'll just give you a couple of examples to illustrate the point. So, from day one, Corey Hannett's team was resourced and off and racing. Corey staffed himself up, installed himself in the big corner office, appropriated the grand title of Coordinator General. But meanwhile, our planners, dealing with all the new challenges thrown up by the infrastructure agenda, but without any extra resources, were asked to simply keep up. We needed them to adapt, and thanks to the great relationship between Corey and Christine Wyatt, Victoria's chief planner, the resource imbalance has now been addressed, and a true partnership based on mutual authority and accountability has been achieved between the two. The second example, we didn't expose the emerging thinking to all parts of government, so why would we? Why would we involve the social policy or economic development departments and agencies and get them at the table? Well, because government has ambitious project apprenticeship targets. We're making decisions that require the careful navigation of free trade agreements, and we have an ever-increasing expectation that projects both create and capture public value. Projects are confronting difficult issues of native title and affordable housing, and they're evolving alongside planning rules like the Central City Planning Controls. Now, within these two examples lie areas of interest and responsibility across the entire length and breadth of the Victorian Public Service. So what do we do? In short, we came to recognise that a bespoke arrangement integrated into standing structures could only help, and I'm happy to report that it has. So we created the Infrastructure Coordination Committee. It's chaired by me, it's serviced by my department, it brings together on a monthly basis public service leaders, including departmental secretaries, the Coordinator General and project CEOs, to provide direct line of sight into projects and early ventilation of issues. So by identifying the upcoming key government decision points, the committee can act as a clearinghouse before Cabinet Committee consideration through discussion, crystallising the public services advice and commissioning additional cross-cutting advice where necessary. Essentially, we're ironing out the issues as far as possible before they're considered by government. Now, the representation on the committee is also evolving. For example, realising the impact that the infrastructure projects we're discussing had on the urban design of Melbourne, Jill Garner, our Victorian government architect, was added as a member. So this ensures that design outcomes, such as livability and accessibility, are front of mind in discussions about the scope and interface of projects. So to give you a flavour of the committee's work and insight into the agenda. So in addition to the routine updates that we get on the Metro Tunnel and Level Crossing Removal Program, a recent agenda included discussion of issues such as the planned Melbourne Refresh Project and its impact on transport network planning, industry capacity and capability with the anticipated procurement schedule, and a report into the economic and tax impacts of major projects. So taking one typical issue considered by the committee a little further, it gives you a bit of an insight into our working model. The committee was asked to review the skills attainment opportunities identified through the delivery of Melbourne Metro and the level crossing removal projects. The committee discussed and endorsed further investigation of skills attainment opportunities beyond those identified through these projects. These included considering partnerships with tertiary institutions and including targets for disadvantaged workers. The discussion also focused on how the infrastructure agenda could facilitate jobs for transitioning workforces and industries, such as the automotive manufacturing sector. On the advice of the Infrastructure Coordination Committee, government has adopted workforce targets and skills attainment measures into procurement for all major projects, contributing to the creation of the 150,000 jobs under the government. Now, this adaptation of public service decision-making processes has been mirrored by changes to the Cabinet decision-making process. So Cabinet initially considered infrastructure projects either in the Policy Subcommittee, which examines all major matters across the full policy landscape in their early development, or the Expenditure Review Subcommittee, which concentrates on funding and finances. This arrangement proved not to be sufficiently focused and streamlined to enable all the project decisions by the government's infrastructure agenda to be considered in a manner that supported the aggressive delivery timetable. So in September 2015, the Premier determined that Cabinet should have a dedicated committee for priority infrastructure projects to supplement the roles of the existing committees. Bringing together a small number of key ministers with input to project decision making and chaired by the Premier, the Priority Infrastructure Subcommittee makes the key decisions on all major projects underway, including the interfaces between those projects, and minimises any delay for project rollout. Having a dedicated subcommittee with senior ministers considering infrastructure projects also invites a broader consideration of issues affecting these key projects, which ultimately delivers a faster conclusion. It's our version of measure twice, cut once. An example of how these new adaptable processes of government improve the outcomes for Victoria in the delivery of the infrastructure agenda is the management of disruption caused by transport, construction and occupation periods. Government has set the vision of what it wants to achieve, and it's exciting. However, the road to get there is literally paved with rail occupations, road closures and construction zones. Our infrastructure experts, together with their policy colleagues, are considering how sequencing and coordination between projects can be optimised to ensure that it is as painless and efficient as possible. Now, we recently hit our stride in achieving great outcomes through the management of Coroit Creek road level crossing removal. This election commitment was coordinated to include other works required in the same location, such as the partial duplication of the Altona loop, and resulted in minimisation of disruption in the area. It's a great outcome in terms of public transport services, safety improvements and increased productivity of the freight network, and demonstrates how thinking pragmatically about communities and how our work impacts on them can be minimised when we put our mind to it. Efficiencies can also be achieved when procurement is coordinated. With a program of 50 level crossings to be removed, it's vital that we use innovative approaches to procurement that maintain flexibility for the market while achieving value for money. Through well-considered procurement methods developed in consultation across government, such as the innovative program alliances, we're able to reduce the resources, costs and time impacts both stateside and for the market. Once that's achieved, we're also ensuring that the outcomes sought from the infrastructure projects include social, environmental and economic value for the community, a legacy not just of the projects successfully being delivered, but also providing support to local industries through local content targets, jobs for apprentices and great design outcomes for local communities. So it is by having the fora at both the bureaucratic and ministerial level to consider these issues and an appetite to try something new that we can capitalise on these efficiencies and benefits. Furthermore, by having experts spread across government and agile processes in place to bring them together, the public service is primed for responding to the private sector. Government can respond quickly to new opportunities. For example, projects like the Western Distributor demonstrate how the government can respond with speed and precision to market-led proposals to supplement the agenda set by government. Now, one way that your ability to deliver solutions for government is enhanced is by knowing what it is that government requires as far in advance as possible. And that's where the work of Infrastructure Victoria comes in. To get advice on future infrastructure planning, government has established Infrastructure Victoria, so that in addition to delivering the current infrastructure agenda, an independent body is considering the next generation of strategic opportunities. Led by the CEO, Michelle Masson, and chaired by your Deputy Chair, Jim Miller, IV has been established to provide independent advice on the infrastructure priorities of the state. And this advice is going to assist government in planning for the growth that we know is going to happen over the next 20 years. IV's key priority this year is preparing a 30-year strategy for Victoria's infrastructure. It's going to outline short, medium and long-term infrastructure needs and priorities, including a pipeline of projects. They've consulted with the community, including seeking the expertise of the people within this room, to ensure that the strategy is informed by the best possible evidence and advice. Underpinned by Infrastructure Victoria's core objectives to improve social, economic and environmental outcomes for the state, the strategy will respond to emerging needs and pressures facing Victoria, and it won't be a static document. As outlined in the legislation, it will be reviewed and updated by Infrastructure Victoria every 3 to 5 years, and these updates will be self-initiated by Infrastructure Victoria, not directed by the state. The strategy is going to cover all sectors: transport, health, culture, sport, education, water, justice, ICT, agriculture and energy. Now, government already has a number of strategies in place and in development for considering how the state will look in the future. We've got Plan Melbourne, currently being refreshed, that outlines the planning and land use directions for the state over the next 30 years. And then there are PTV's network development plans, that outline how the public transport network will be developed to connect Melbourne and Victoria. There's a plan for schools, there's a plan for health and human services, a plan for justice, and a plan for water. Now, government also has strategies in place by geographic area. We know that we need to identify and plan for strategic locations across Melbourne and Victoria that can accommodate future growth. Urban renewal initiatives such as the Arden Precinct or Fisherman's Bend can't be undertaken without also considering the infrastructure that supports development, but also that will be required over the longer term. Developing these urban renewal areas are key to supporting population growth and building our reputation as a knowledge-intensive service economy over the next 30 years. Infrastructure Victoria's strategy will take all the work that government has underway and provide advice as to the ways that the work can be enhanced through better use of existing infrastructure or new projects that will lead to greater economic, social and environmental benefits for the state. And we know that when considered holistically and delivered in a coordinated and integrated way, the accumulative value is greater than any single project alone. Now, in response to Victoria's independent strategy, government will prepare a response, including its five-year infrastructure plan. Now, preparing this plan again requires the public service to evolve its operating model to ensure that we can deliver a product that's able to match and respond to the breadth of Infrastructure Victoria's work. What the response to Infrastructure Victoria's 30-year strategy will require is a cross-cutting plan to consider infrastructure needs and solutions. For instance, are there innovative ways that the plans for housing and land use can be achieved in conjunction with transport priorities? Can the way we deliver education infrastructure be coordinated with active transport routes to help achieve health and lifestyle improvements? More and more, we are looking at ways of collaborating, of innovating, and of addressing multiple hard problems with one solution. Now, to prepare government's response, a dedicated team will be brought together in my department with experts from across the public service to ensure that a unified strategy incorporating all these areas can be provided. That team will take the plans and strategies already in place and bring these together with the advice of Infrastructure Victoria to ensure we are well placed to achieve the outcomes sought. Simply put, a livable, prosperous Victoria for both the short and long term. Now, one part of government's response will be a five-year plan to guide infrastructure priorities for government investment. Our aspiration is that this work can be updated annually and applied to complement the state budget-related work. So how is this any different to government's approach to infrastructure investment as part of the annual budget? Well, the five-year plans will be pegged against the 30-year strategy and its future iterations. For you, our friends in the private sector, by clearly setting out government's priorities reaching beyond the forward estimate cycle, there's the opportunity for you to access and assess our key priorities, locate these priorities within the 30-year strategy narrative, and engage with us on how they might be delivered. Not only can this start a general conversation between government and the private sector about innovative ways that the priorities can be delivered, it will also allow you to plan more confidently to support your investment decisions. Now, I know from experience that many of the best solutions are going to come from the engineering, planning or commercial experts in the private sector. And by having a long-term strategy as a reference and the five-year plan as a specific guide, the settings are right for these ideas to flourish. I hope from this brief exposure to my world, this glimpse between the government doona, that you've got a picture of a public service and a government able to adapt its operating model and decision-making processes to keep pace with and indeed get ahead of the complexity and multidimensional nature of Victoria's infrastructure agenda. I also hope you see, like me, the unique opportunity offered by the Infrastructure Victoria 30-year strategy and how government intends to respond to the strategy for an even stronger partnership between the private sector and government. In the same way, the benefits of a well-conceived and executed infrastructure agenda are greater than the sum of individual projects, so too that partnership can drive innovative solutions that are greater than the sum of our individual imaginations. Thank you.